study, we took the following boundary conditions in account. So it's first of all, there's no chance to purchase electricity from the grid. We allow fossil fuel purchase in the beginning. We allow, let's say, hydrogen purchase as additional option. And we said we give some limits on the CO2 emissions, and we increase them stepwise to come from, let's say, today's system to a fully decarbonized system. While applying this limit, yeah, we allow the optimizer to install renewable energy. The size of the chiller can be determined. We allow for a battery storage, some thermoelectric energy storage, and the cold water storage. And that's basically what we do. So if we start such a process, it's always very important to really have a common understanding of the relevant in and outputs. So we have the data center, and the data center has an electrical load and a cooling load, and they have to be met at each point in time. We say, okay, there's a significant solar potential that we take into consideration. We look at the, let's say, weather conditions, especially to calculate the impact of ambient temperature on the coefficient of performance for the chiller. We see a natural gas price, yeah, with some, and we take into consideration, let's say, the emission factor for the natural gas. We have the option of using diesel as a backup fuel. And we take into consideration hydrogen as fuel with zero carbon intensity. However, talking to the customer, we had a, let's say, intensive discussion on the hydrogen price. And finally, we realized, okay, there's a significant uncertainty with respect to the future hydrogen price. So we agreed to do, let's say, two cases, one with $3 per kilogram and one with $6 per kilogram. And in the following, we will really look at the impact of this assumption, first of all, on cost and on system configuration. If we do this type of analysis, it's important to know that we really have to go to let's say, an hourly resolution, for instance, for a representative year, to grasp fluctuations in demands and generation profiles throughout the day and throughout the year. So, for instance, here you can see, let's say, the power load profile, and you can see, okay, it's basically a fluctuation throughout the day, whereas throughout the year it looks rather stable. If we look to the cooling demand, yeah, you can see both the changes throughout the day and throughout the year. The same holds for ambient temperature and solar PV potential. So once again, yeah, this energy system that we look at. First of all, let's bear in mind, yeah, the data center needs, let's say, reliable power and reliable cooling. So that's the most important thing. And then we say, okay, the reliability comes from, let's say, the thermal equipment. In this case, it's a combined cycle power plant that can burn natural gas and hydrogen, and let's say in cases of emergency, it can also burn diesel. So this is where the electricity comes from in a reliable manner. And as I told you before, we operate a compression chiller, so to supply the cooling. And since we want to decarbonize, we include at this location renewable energy. In this case, specifically, it's a PV. So we have a fluctuating generation here, and we want to balance these fluctuations by either using a battery energy storage and or an electrothermal energy storage. In addition, we'll allow for a chilled water storage that allows to decouple, let's say, cooling and electrical power draw from the compression chillers. So it's a third form of flexibility that we offer to the system. And now let's have a look on the associated cost. Here on the left-hand side, you can see the CO2 emissions and you can see the TOTEX increase. So we normalize the results. So we start at this point and it's 100% CO2 emissions and 100% total expenditures. Total expenditures is the sum of capital expenditures and operational expenditures. Then we force the system to decarbonize. So we go down to 80, 60, 40, 20, and 0% of the primary CO2 footprint. And we see the increase in total expenditures. We see that, let's say, we only see a difference for the $3 and $6 per kilogram of hydrogen price, yeah, in the last step of decarbonization, which means that before, let's say, hydrogen is not used in the system. And then we can see at this point, okay, there is a difference, yeah, but as compared to the difference in hydrogen price, it looks rather small. So let's have a more detailed look at the TOTEX. Once again, TOTEX is the sum of OPEX and CAPEX. And let's say in the baseline case, we started with a given, let's say, ratio of CAPEX and OPEX. And we can see that, let's say, in decarbonization, we see a shift, yeah, that the operational expenditures or the share of operational expenditures decreases while CAPEX increase. And that's very typical if you go for renewable installations. Because the operational expenditures for, let's say, a PV plant are much lower than the capital expenditures. However, in the last step, if we start to burn hydrogen, we see that, let's say, the OPEX share increases again, which can be, which is understandable because, let's say, the price tag here is significant, yeah, and therefore we can see this increase in OPEX share again. So now for the let's come to some intermediate summary. Yeah, we can see, okay, the what we expected in the beginning, yeah, that there is really a major difference according to the hydrogen price. Yeah, we can say, okay, the impact is rather limited in the field of TOTEX. Yeah, and that was somehow surprising. Now let's have a look, let's say, more for the engineers among us, how do the optimal energy systems look like? I know it's a complex slide and I hope that I can walk you through it. Let's have first of all see, okay, on the left hand side we see the energy conversion unit. And on the right-hand side, we see the energy storage unit. Energy storage, let's say, it's always the capacity, so it's basically the tank, yeah, and so the charge and discharge devices, if they are independent, yeah, of this tank size, yeah, they pop up here again. And now let's start with the baseline situation in the $6 per kilogram of hydrogen case. We see we have the combined cycle power plant and we have the compression chiller and we do not have any storage in place. So that's the base case that that we agreed in the beginning. So now we force the system to decarbonize minus 20, minus 40, minus 60, minus 80, minus 100. And we see the capacity additions. And let's say in the first edition, you can see, okay, there's a PV installation and there is, let's say, chilled water storage built and a very small battery storage. And you can see, let's say, capacity wise, yeah, it's very small. in terms of the charging and discharging unit. And here you can see it's let's say small as well. And if we increase the degree of decarbonization, you can see, okay, then the PV installation is getting larger. And the chilled water storage is getting larger. The battery is basically used to compensate for, let's say, small or fast fluctuations. Then if we go to minus 60% CO2, we see a new technology. That's the so-called electrothermal energy storage. The abbreviation is ETS. And the ETS system is a power to heat, heat storage, and then heat to power system. And I think it's a nice coincidence that I think I'm rather sure that Heiko will give you some more insight into the technology and what you can get from this analysis. Yeah, it's interesting if you want to go for decarbonization. It's a technology that really helps you. And here you can see, okay, you have a rather large PV installation, then you have this ETS charging device. You have here, let's say, the tank size, and then you have the discharger. And the charging device takes electricity from the PV that is generated during the daytime, and it's used for day to night shift. So, and it becomes, let's say, larger and larger till, let's say, you really reach full decarbonization. Here you can basically see, let's say, a chilled water storage is always a significant part. Yeah, you have a small battery capacity, and you really have some significant, let's say, heat storage size in here. And what is interesting to notice as well, if we now do again the comparison between the $6 and $3 per kilogram hydrogen case, you can see that up to a level of decarbonization, like of 80%, the systems are really identical. And only if you then say, okay, you really want to go for full decarbonization, then let's say hydrogen as the fuel becomes relevant. And if the hydrogen price is $3 per kilogram of hydrogen, then let's say the capacity additions in the last step are somehow limited. Whereas with the $6 per kilogram of hydrogen, there is again a significant addition in PV capacity and some addition in ETS charging capacity. Because let's say they are in, let's say, economic competition to burning hydrogen. But again, I think, up to this degree of decarbonization of 80%, there is no impact, and afterwards is the impact. And I think this is really, let's say, an excellent basis for a stepwise approach, because, let's say, typically you won't go from today to full decarbonization in one step. And this example really shows, okay, you can start today, and you are not in danger of doing a move that you afterwards regret, because you can, till 80%, it's identical. And let's say if 80% for you is in whatever, 26 or 27, then you know much better if the hydrogen price in the future will be $3 or $6 per kilogram. And then you can take the decision, are you to the extent of capacity additions that you will do. So this were, let's say, more, let's say, high level results. If we do such an analysis and we discuss with engineers, then we always look to, let's say, annual energy flows displayed here in the Sankey diagram, or we look to the dispatch that shows really the complex interaction of all the energy conversion and storage technologies that have been selected. So now let's move to the next example. We stay in the Middle East and we look to the food and beverage industry. So the current situation is as follows. We have a customer operating a sugar factory and a sugar beet farm with an electricity demand larger than 100 megawatt electric. And there is a process steam demand larger than 100 megawatt thermal. And currently they use gas boilers to generate this steam. So in this case, the customer is basically asking, electricity from the grid is kind of expensive, and are there cheaper options? And fortunately, we have, the option to install PV and battery. And there's a natural gas grid connection available. And what we now do is we develop an optimized hybrid energy system consisting of renewables on the one hand and, let's say, a fossil backup on the other hand. And we want to demonstrate the synergies of looking at electricity and process heat in a holistic way. And we do, again, this energy system design study for this. And again, we, at the very beginning, it's always important to agree on the system boundaries. So as I told you, we have the sugar factory with an electricity and a steam demand. In addition, we have the sugar beet farm. It is important for you to know, if you're not from the sugar industry, for instance, I did not know before, that, let's say, the sugar factory is operated only for a limited amount of time. So it's only 5 months per year. Because, they only can operate the sugar plant if they the sugar has to grow in the meantime, so this is important to notice. And as I told you, we have the natural gas connection, and we have the power grid connection. And basically, in the base case, we see a system like this: the electricity is taken from the grid, and the gas is taken from the grid, used in the boilers, and then the boilers produce the steam. That's what we call in the future the reference scenario. And now we go to this to our energy system design. And first of all, it's again introducing the technological options. I mentioned we have the solar potential and the wind potential. So we can generate renewable electricity. We look at several gas turbine options with heat recovery. We look again to the electrothermal energy storage and to the battery energy storage, and we allow for process steam generation using an electric boiler. And we included, let's say, the performance and price information, as well as the weighted average capital cost that we agreed on with the customer. And these are now all the options that the optimizer can select from. And in this case, we figured out that there is a gas turbine option with a heat recovery. The combined heat and power production is really something that's economically beneficial as compared to the gas use in the gas boilers only. And we saw that, the wind turbines are a viable option. And at this point, it was not that straightforward. We were all surprised that, for instance, solar PV was not part of the solution. Frankly speaking, at the beginning, it gave us a headache. We double checked several times, and then we understood that this is really a phenomenon resulting from the unconventional load profiles in the sugar factory and the sugar beet farm, which is interesting. Yeah, and basically, let's say during the day there is not that much electricity demand, so the PV generation always would, or to a very high share, would need an intermediate storage to be used in the factory or in the farm. All in all, we were able to say, okay, we get a TOTEX reduction by 20%. At the same time, yeah, we could save CO2 emissions by 20% as well. Here again, we can see, let's say, the result more, let's say, in a graphical manner. So we have in the reference case, we have the power draw from the grid with some peak demand. And as compared to the peak, we see in the optimized case, yeah, we have a significant wind installation. We have the gas turbine with heat recovery, and we will still, let's say, use electricity from the grid, especially to meet peak demands, while, however, let's say reducing the energy that we get from the grid significantly, which is then the reason why we can save money. And here you can see, let's say, the shift in TOTEX, yeah, from a pure OPEX system, yeah, buying electricity, we get to a mixed CAPEX and OPEX system due to the investment that we took. Once again, we have, first of all, the synergy in electricity and steam production, and the reduction of total expenditures by 20%. So now let me come to give you a short overview on a more complex system. It's only a high level overview that I can give you, because it's really the information that we share in this field is very confidential, is confidential, and so it is more a high level overview that I give you in this field. Let's start in the middle with this circle. Yeah, it's an existing coal-fired power plant. Yeah, and if you look, okay, today daily business is really, okay, the interaction with the electrical grid. Yeah, they sell electricity to the grid, and they produce, process steam, and sell it to nearby industries. And let's say in this case, the government decided that in 2030 there will be no coal firing anymore. And in addition, the site is, let's say, very close to some wind farms. Yeah, so there will be. It's expected that the electricity price will fluctuate significantly, and the question is, okay, are there some chances associated to this site coming from this renewable fluctuations? In this context, we look to, let's say, thermal energy storage, we look to sector coupling, power to heat, we look to battery storage, we look to green and blue hydrogen generation. In addition, let's say in the future, there might be the option to sell district heating to the city district. The nearby industry could be interested not only into steam, but also in, let's say, electricity and hydrogen. And hydrogen, let's say, the hydrogen price that you can get if you sell the hydrogen to transport applications, yeah, can be really attractive. So we take into consideration hydrogen sales to the transport sector as well. And for sure, let's say this more like a marketing slide. Yeah, and if you want to have a first overview what this means on the modeling side, I can show you this slide. So you can see here, first of all, this is everything that is, let's say, coming in. That's everything that is coming out. And in between, you can see all this, let's say, white boxes. In this case, it's 63 different energy conversion and storage options that are considered with different, let's say, combining different types of energy. What is always very important, yeah, let's say, to get all the data that is relevant is significant work, yeah, and we really hope that this then pays off. For instance, here you can say, okay, you have the electricity purchase, yeah, then we get here an hourly price profile. We take into consideration the grid fees, the taxes. We take into consideration the CO2 footprint of the electricity bought from the grid. As I told you, we as, let's say, equipment manufacturer have all the information on this potential energy conversion and storage unit at different sizes for sure. For instance, here we have the price and performance indications for an SGT 2000E. And we have all this data that is necessary to really evaluate, let's say, new options. For instance, in this case, we have the CO2 emissions and, let's say, the taxes that have to be paid if you emit them. And in this case, let's say, the price tag for CO2 emissions from electricity production differs from the price tag for CO2 coming from process steam production. So all these details have to be considered. And then it's a quite a comprehensive study that we do. So let me come to an end and summarize. So we have decarbonizing energy systems really requires a holistic step-by-step approach and balancing decarbonization targets on the one hand with economical and technical boundary conditions on the other hand is key. And in this context, energy system design can help to elaborate a tailor-made energy system design and identify viable steps towards decarbonization. And the methodology can be applied to very different types of energy systems. And we as Siemens Energy, we want to be your one-stop shop for decarbonization from, let's say, first thought, initial assessments, up to really a plant that is ready for low carbon operation. So now I'm really looking forward to your questions.
Thank you, Dr. Schaefer. We do have indeed some questions here. Here we have a question the user is asking, hydrocarbon products are heavily taxed, whereas alternatives are heavily subsidized. How do you see governments handling this loss of income due to decarbonization and increasing costs to subsidized alternatives?
Yeah, let's say first of all, one thing that is important, we can include this subsidy schemes into our energy system design. And we do so, as I, for instance, indicated that we can have different carbon price tags on CO2 emissions from process steam and from electricity production, for instance. So we think it's very relevant and crucial to include it in the energy system design. On the other hand, let's say I'm a citizen and I'm a taxpayer, and I really think that that I hope that in the government, somebody is sitting there and says, okay, finally someone has to pay the bill. I think there are a lot of whatever universities and research institutions that do this type of energy system design more on a national or supranational level. And I think if you calculate, do this, let's say, without considering, subsidies, you really can calculate something like a cost optimal pathway for a country. And I hope that in the government, people sit and say, okay, this is the cost optimal pathway, and I use the subsidies wisely to stimulate, let's say, a progress into the right direction. But not, let's say, that in whatever 2035, let's say, baseload electricity has to be subsidized.
Thank you. The second question we have is, what are we offering for, what solutions are we offering for developing countries that are reasonable and affordable in cost?
I think in this case, it is, as you saw, let's say the energy system designed can help you to minimize costs at given CO2 targets. So first of all, in this type, we can support to develop concepts. However, there will be some investment costs remaining. And in this point in time, that probably, or let's say, we can then help to find find funding, but perhaps somebody from the Middle East region can give me or can join our discussion and give some hints in this field. Mahmoud.
Maybe let me comment. I have a general comment because I was reading also in parallel the questions. Then the key takeaway of this question is that this decarbonization approach, which everybody's talking about, this is mainly driven by European continent. They want to be CO2 neutral by 2050, and there is plenty of money. So they come from Brussels. Same now with the US, that they are back, Joe Biden, and then they are printing the US dollar a lot. And that's it. So the rest of the world, if you look at Africa, if you look at China, in India, they're still into the coal business, for example, Latin America, maybe less. So now the question is, if you want to reduce the CO2 emission for Europe, but you have plenty of CO2 coming from the rest of the world, why? Again, what we are trying to do is this is a contribution. So we as a Siemens, and there's a lot of companies like us also, they said, okay, to be honest, we don't care about who is investing in coal because we are exiting this business. However, we would like to provide solutions to serve the whoever customer is willing to reduce his, CO2 footprint. Now the question, at which cost? As Jochen mentioned, this is case by case. There are certain countries that give subsidies, like in Germany, let's be honest about it. And there's also for hydrogen, there's grants you can apply for and you get it. This is not the case in the Middle East for the time being. In the Middle East, as we see it, for example, we see it in UAE, there are certain projects like this data center. Yeah, where they want to have it as a pilot project, they want to understand, to learn the technology, and then sooner or later, the cost will be reduced, and then we move to the next phase. In Saudi Arabia, for example, if you look at the NEOM business, production of hydrogen and ammonia and export, there is a business case, apparently, and then there is no subsidies coming from the government. However, there is a certain support. And then if you want to apply this now in Africa, as per today, this will not be possible. We should be open about that. At least this is the way I see it. If you look, go back now to China. China also, even though they want to keep certain level of growth, and they cannot get rid of the coal, for example. They will need it. However, they are investing big time in renewable and in hydrogen. They may announce also the strategy regarding hydrogen. So they want also not to be left behind Europe and the US. They want to catch up. And this should be also the way it happened.
And I think there's one more point that I would like to add. It is really, even in the Middle East region, if there is no subsidy, then, for instance, your PV potential is very, very significant, and as the or the wind potential in some locations, and really, let's say, renewable energies are often in your region part of the cost optimal solution. So and as I showed with the sugar factory, the cheapest way of heat and power supply is including wind at this location. Yeah? And so you can save CO2 emissions and cost at the same in one step. Yeah? And I think this is really what I think is very attractive. Yeah. And then one challenge is, but there I think we can help, is that you say, okay, you do not get locked in a situation where you do okay a first step, and the next step means basically you need something completely different, and there I think we could help as well.
Thank you.
Yeah,
I think we have to move on to the next presentation. However, we're going to respond to your questions, and we're going to share them with the SMEs at Siemens, and we'll come back to you with the answers. Also, guys, if you have any more questions, please do not hesitate. Send us an email with your question through our email at info@asme-esas.org. We move to the second topic of the event, which is the future of energy storage, which will be delivered by Mr. Heiko Grootens. Mr. Grootens holds a diploma in electrical engineering and a master's degree in organizational management. He has more than 13 years in the energy division. Mr. Grootens, the floor is yours.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Hasan. Hope you can hear me well. First of all, we have to choose a little problem because so far I'm not up. Yeah, now it works. Now I'm a speaker. Can you see my desktop?
Loud and clear.
Perfect. Yeah, also welcome from my side. My name is Heiko Grootens. I'm part member of the new founded storage organization. This is Siemens Energy Generation. And I'm looking forward here to discuss with you the topic of energy storage. Yeah, and as my previous speaker, Jochen, already mentioned, I like to give you some information regarding more the technologies themselves. As Manam said at his introduction speech, we are now Siemens Energy and working along the entire value chain of energy and providing products and solutions. So where we are come from, of course, is generation and also transmissions, and in the last decade we all see the renewables, and we have here also our products available. And besides all the industrial applications, we built up currently as a new energy business with the core of the electrolyzers to produce and provide H2. And what's part of my presentation today is that we also step in already into the field of storage. Yeah? And there, of course, we're also looking into the topic of batteries, partnering here with the company Fluence, who will provide us the battery cells. And there on this base, we then provide out of generation, I have to say, solutions for integration into existing assets. So I come to that later on, called C-Start, larger battery applications. In the, as a standalone battery applications are provided by our colleagues from transmission. The second topic here, thermal storage, where we just, we as Siemens Energy started to look in more detail in and build up now a product portfolio with a partner ecosystem. That's the second priority so far in our point of view. To address here also different use cases. Yeah, you see here on the right hand side, there's not only one use case, there are several different use cases, and also we'll come to this in more detail. Not one technology will fit all of the use case in the same manner. Yeah, what is the motivation for storage? Yeah, it's also already discussed in Jochen's presentation. We have to step out of coal. We have to decarbonize the world. Yeah, and due to this, we see more and more renewables in the worldwide grids. And that means that the provision of energy is more and more not constant, but is fluctuating. And that is means that we somehow have to solve the issue that demand and production won't fit perfectly together anymore. And one of the solution for this challenge is, of course, storage. Just store surplus renewable energy in the time when it's not needed, and provide the stored energy then in the times when the sun is not shining or the wind is not blowing, and we need energy. That is relatively easy. And due to the fact that you can see on the left hand side, we expect that until the mid of this century, we will more or less have 50% out of renewables. The demand for storage applications will increase. We see already the batteries in the grid. The strong pull for batteries, in my point of view, is coming from the electric vehicles. As the market sees this huge potential for this millions over millions of cars in the future, and that is the main driver for it, or was the main driver to put in a lot of R&D money, billions over billions in this technology. Therefore, we see already this product available. We also see or saw in the last years the strong falling costs and prices for these technologies. Due to this, we see also this technology already in the grids, providing here energy on relatively short notice. And that is worthwhile to have it and brings a lot of value into the challenges of the future grids, reducing more and more the fossil power plants with their rotating equipment and also losing the inertia at this moment. And that means overall a lot of challenges for the grid stability. And on the other hand, then, of course, thermal storage, because batteries, can say this in advance, are relatively expensive regarding longer duration output. We see this especially as a technology for a duration output of up to 4 or 5 hours. And what we also see already are requests for longer duration output, for 8 hours and more. And if you want to provide this out of a battery, that does easily mean you have to put twice the amount of battery there, and you have no real scaling effect. So you will double also the prices, and that maybe is a real disadvantage of the batteries, that there is no positive scaling effect regarding the capacity. And that would be then the playing ground and playing field for the thermal application, but I will come to this. Maybe one slide regarding hybrid systems, also as storage will part of hybrid systems. Here above you see the issue. Unfortunately, burning coal means a lot of CO2 productions. And of course, you already hear that Siemens Energy stepped out of this business, more or less. We still focus on combined cycle power plants. Here, burning gas, which is much more efficient regarding the CO2, also efficient in the way that it produces much less CO2 than burning coal. And here, not only producing electricity, for example, in Germany, it's not allowed to build a combined cycle power plant without using also the thermal energy, combined heat and power. And with this, you come also to round overall efficiency of the energy in the fossil fuel of more than 80%. And that overall reduce strongly here the emissions of CO2. And the next step would be then using hybrid systems and integrating surplus renewable energy and energy storage, combine this to a hybrid system, and that further will reduce here the overall goal to reduce the CO2 emissions. And as said, energy storage will here play a major role also into hybrid systems and also in energy future systems, as also was shown by Jochen, and play here an important role. Good, here an overview on the left-hand side about different technologies. There's not only one. We see here, starting on the left-hand side with the batteries always. So this is at least a logarithm scale. Due to this, in the logarithm scale, always the battery field is that huge. If you have a linear scale, if you imagine a linear scale, the battery field would be really much shorter. But nevertheless, it just shows an overview about different technologies and where are their playing fields. So I already said a little bit about batteries. We see this for several hours, up to 4 or 5 hours useful. You see, but also, of course, meanwhile, this huge storage plants based on batteries, especially in US, but also Australia and others, up to really huge power output, 100 megawatts and more. That's already there. On the other hand, if we talk about much more power and especially a longer duration, we have this hydrogen, the power to X field, especially seasonal storage, for example, if you have to store energy, not about hours or days or weeks, but over months, to store energy produced in the hot summer and transferred in the colder winter, for example, whereas also the sun not that shining. There is so far power to X more or less the only real solution available. Maybe compressed air could be part of the solution, but I think most of this topic of seasonal storage will be has to be solved by power to X. Some type could also play a role, but this is limited to geographical restrictions here. You have not everywhere possible or fitting areas to install this pumped hydro applications where you need at least a lake, something like that, on a relatively higher area. That, of course, could be also support and sizzle storage request. But in between here, so regarding the power output and also the duration time of the power, we see here really the applications of thermal mechanical storage systems. And I will focus today here in my presentation to the thermal applications. On the right-hand side, our current product portfolio in an overview. So I will go more into the details, as mentioned here, into the ETIS systems of our colleagues from Siemens Gamesa. This is a thermal storage based on volcanic stones. We partner with a company called Energy Nest. They developed a thermal battery. And here we see especially applications within industrial services. In our portfolio is also the thermomechanical part with pumped heat energy storage application. There we partner with a company called Malta. This is a startup developing since several years on a pumped heat energy storage application. This is a carve-out of the Google X company, and there we will provide for this, especially the compressor train and the expander train, which is needed here for this storage. Yeah. And last but not least, we have, of course, the topic of batteries. Also, I mentioned our cooperation with Fluence. What is not here on the right-hand side, just to mention it, we have also a solution available for compressed air energy storage as an in-house solution. That could be especially interesting where a cavern is available due to the need of a cavern to stores the compressed air then, but compressed air, I would not go into more details here today. Yeah, I just said no technology fit all use cases. This is an overview here about different use cases. We see, for example, I mentioned this seasonal balancing bring energy from the summer time into the autumn winter time. Long term storage. Capacity firming. The renewables are fluctuating, and here to provide 24/7 power out also of renewables. One really important use case in our point of view is also the decarbonization of existing assets. So there are round about 7,000 coal-fired power plants in the world, and not every of them is 40 or 50 years old. There are also new ones. And what to do with all these assets? Yeah, this is, of course, the question of the customer who invested a lot of money in them. And here, it's not possible and not useful to convert each and every of them into a storage power plant. But I think personally also at least some of them make use to think about this, to convert them into the storage power plant. And here could especially all the thermal storage give an answer. Then we see use cases also in the transmissions, also in the grids, by transmission distribution here. Maybe via storage we can avoid to expand too much the grids. Yeah, there's also a lot of discussion always. Yeah, if I can talk a little bit about Germany, if you want to build a new transmission line, You can trust me, you have a lot of political trouble and it will take years bis you get the acceptance by all the people who will see the transmission line in front of them. And due to the fact here in Germany, we already will build a lot of them underground. And this is really increasing the cost. Yeah. And then maybe it is better to have a huge storage in the grid somewhere and save or avoid building a transmission line. Yeah, that's also a use case we see, and grid support, yeah, grid stabilization. I mentioned the topic of inertia already. If you step out of conventional power plants, losing all these rotating masses which stabilize with their stored energy in the rotating mass. The inertia, that is a huge challenge for the grid stability, and he also here is especially flywheel or batteries an answer. Last but not least, here on the right hand side, we see the industrial heat services. So also the industrial customers and industrial plants will play a major role by decarbonizing the world. There's a lot of heat necessary for their processes, which so far are mostly provided by fossil fuel. And here is also the need to step into the renewables and to here also the storage topic could play an important role for decarbonizing industrial processes. And then below the different technologies, yeah, that's and just an overview, yeah, not too detailed, yeah, but maybe it's clear, yeah, that's for again, yeah, this use case of seasonal storage, that a battery is not an answer, yeah, even thermal storage is here not an answer, because you have thermal losses of round about 1% per day. Yeah, and that means that after at least 100 days, the storage would be completely empty. So power to X is here the answer. Maybe pumped hydro could support, and also compressed energy storage. Decarbonization, here we see especially the advantage of thermal, because we're talking about a thermal power plant, and there are thermal storage. Could support here the decarbonization, but also thermomechanical applications maybe, and last but not least, batteries could here play a role by decarbonization of the existing fleet. And maybe in third example, talking about synchronized grid stabilization, and there is also, again, battery not an answer, because you get not, battery is not rotating mass, you have no inertia, and therefore the flywheel, flywheel can provide a lot of energy on really, really short notice, not that much, but really fast, so it's an inertia at least. And therefore, I think it's worthwhile to not think only about, as my impression was in the last couple of years, if you ask 10 people regarding storage, you get by 9 the answer we're talking about only batteries. Yeah, and I think this future will show that we see beside batteries and also beside power to X on the other side. Yeah, of all these use cases, and of the duration, that we see also other technologies out of the area of thermal, out of the area of thermal mechanical storage, like compressed air, pumped heat, or liquid air energy storage. And there, maybe it says it also in advance, the technology race is so far a little bit open. So there is all of these different technologies looking for a first-time application. All these different technologies have an interesting project pipeline and interested customers. But so far, we not really see an really built plant. Yeah. But this is also my point of view to this. It will not need a lot of years. I personally think we will see the first really plants then in the next maybe year, either 2022 or latest 2023, we will see first really applications. Good. Then talking about technology, here regarding the battery on the left-hand side, you see here an example for the battery cube. What is the message from this picture? Battery is not only the cell itself. Yeah, you need a system around, you need inverters, you need transformers and other connections to have a complete system. We are providing this here out of generation, as mentioned, especially for the integration into power plants, and that is our core. And maybe what is the advantage of a battery? If you look here on the next page, you see the comparison of these two lines of the red one and the more blue or gray one here. And what these lines show, starting with the red one, that is, for example, a pure gas turbine operation. Now you will start running on base loads, will reduce the load and ramp up again and shut down. And then here in the blue line is a combination of a gas turbine with a battery, and then you can see it in advance the benefit of such a battery system. You have, for example, the battery, if you could more left, as a first use case, that you have a black start capability now available. Without the diesel burning fuel, you have the battery, you can use the energy stored in the battery for starting up your gas turbine system. First use case. Then second use case here, and second benefit is you can start much faster providing energy to the system. You're talking here about milliseconds, and you can bridge the time until the gas turbine is started and will run on base load. You can also can here much faster provide energy already. You can do a real frequency response, so primary and secondary frequency response out of the battery. You can much faster ramp down as you have a hybrid system and can store then energy in the batteries, then providing it to the grid, and also vice versa again. You have spinning reserve or the peak load capability out of the system. And last but not least, you have here, especially in Ireland, off-grid operation, also further benefits using here the battery and being independent. That is an overview of the benefits of a battery in combination with a gas turbine plant, like a one-cycle power plant, and here we are currently, as mentioned, working together with Fluence and currently improving here our systems and yeah, that's maybe to the battery systems. Good, next topic, and that would be the core of my presentation then here today, the topic of thermal energy storage. And here you see on the left-hand side an overview about our product portfolio. We have available, more or less available, regarding here different technologies. So above, already mentioned the ETIS topic in the middle, the energy nest topic, and the low Tor, and Tor, we also come to this as an in-house development, especially for the combination with the Gombon cycle power plant. And if you want to know as an overview what are the differences and why we are looking at three different thermal energy storage applications, there are reasons to this. One reason is that there are different temperature levels, for example. So ETS and TOR are able to store temperature on the level of 720 degrees. Energy is so far not able to reach such high level of temperature. There's one difference, and the other difference is the way of loading. So is ETS especially, or ETS especially will be loaded via surplus renewable energy. Here, this is a yellow arrow. And it is also possible to be loaded with heat or thermal energy direct, but that would mean additional heat exchanger. Energy nest is able to be direct loaded with thermal energy, and also Thor has a big advantage, especially to be loaded with exhaust gas. And that's here the reason why we think in three products. And also on the on the side of using the energy, especially ETS here and TOR regarding to the temperature level are able to provide out of the thermal energy electricity again due to this temperature level and energy nest receive more using the energy for using the thermal energy direct in the form of district heating or process heating. That's just an overview, and here I will then step into the details of the different technologies. So ETS was developed over the last decade by our colleagues from Siemens Gamesa. And on the right-hand side, you see a picture of such a plant here. This in the picture is a demonstrator that built, starts operation 2 years ago, as it was built in the Hamburg Harbor area. And this is a so-called ETS base system. So it's a greenfield application. You have here in this building with a mammoth on the wall, which gives a link to the stones. We have so a relatively easy concrete building, this building is filled up with volcanic stones. So nothing special about doing this. So you have just to put them in there as a pebble bed. Of course, you have to know which stones you should use, because you will heat them up over and over again until relatively high temperature. And the task here is that at the end you have again always and always stones and not sand on the one hand, or they should also not melt. So you have to think about, and that's also part of the LP, which stones are usable for this application. If you know, then you just can use them, put them into them, and then you have here the capacity part of the storage. Then the question how to load or to charge and to discharge, and here's the working media, the heat transfer fluid is air. You just heat up the air with an electrical heater. Here, not that good to see. Here, the silver pipes are the air pipes of the system, and in between is the electrical heater. And with the surplus energy out of renewables, you heat up the air up to currently 800 degrees. and blow the heated up air through this pebble bed of stones and bring the energy or transfer the energy from the air to the pebble bed, to the stones. Doing this, and that's the charging mode, relatively easy, and the discharging mode is then blowing cold air from the other side through the heated up volcanic stones, heat up the air again up to 650 degrees or even higher, and using Herzig and normal Herzig for producing then out of the energy in the hot air steam. And the steam is then via steam turbine and generator then reactivate to electricity. Yeah? So relatively easy, simple principle. I have it here also as a working principle diagram. Yeah, what we saw in the picture from the demonstrator here is working principle. Yeah, you have here the storage, the resistive heater. You blow cold air in circle, heat it up with a resistive heater up to here 720 degrees. Next step would be 800 degrees. There is also a potential to heat it higher up to 1,000 degrees, but that would need a little bit more R&D effort. And then have you here doing this in the circle. And by the way, doing this in this closed loop, you also reduce your energy losses. And optimize in this way the system. And yeah, you heat it up until the storage is filled. And then reactivation means blowing cold air here through the volcanic stones, heat it up via an Herzig steam turbine generator, also via absolutely normal standard water steam cycle. Yeah, it's more or less the reactivation part is a small or is a steam power plant, but not within boiler, but within Herzig. Yeah? And there you reactivify your stored energy. And I mentioned combined heat and power. Of course, it's also possible to use energy out of the system for providing district heating or process steam and coming here to better round-trip efficiencies. Because it is, to be very open, yeah, and it's also clear by Carnot, the round-trip efficiency of such a system is then limited. Yeah? Again, here's the demonstrator. It's a really small approach. There is only 1.5 megawatt electrical output and 36 megawatt electrical capacity. Has really a relatively poor roundup efficiency of around about 22-23%. Yeah, but it's a demonstrator, and the whole system here was optimized in that way to demonstrate the new element. And the new element is the heater, the storage building itself, yeah, and to learn more about the behavior of the storage, yeah, and to learn and to check if all the models behind, yeah, are in fitting to our the results of the test are in line. I want to say in line with the models. They were calculated in front. Yeah. And in reality, yeah, later on in real projects, we're thinking in three product lines, and this ET is base, add, and switch. And maybe let's start with switch, where we integrate such a system into an existing power plant. Yeah. And doing this, we are not talking about the small demonstrator application, but integrating it in power plants, maybe up to 1 gigawatt power output, yeah, and with a really huge water steam cycle behind. And then you come up to roundup efficiencies up to, with some tricks, 50%, yeah, due to the fact that the roundtrip efficiency of such a huge power plant is in the size. So you see the overall roundtrip efficiency is depending also to the system where we integrate such a storage system. And especially here, we see interest of the customer side, because I mentioned the issue of the customer who invested a lot of money in their fleet, in power plants, and due to the fact we have to faster step out, they see the pressure, how to survive with their assets, and at least with such an approach, you can in the first step reduce burning coal, and maybe as a vision, maybe not 2025, but it's of course here developments to do, our visionary, it is possible and thinkable that we then can drive such a huge power plant only about the energy out of such storage systems, and avoiding here completely burning coal and using the existing assets of the water steam cycle. So that's ET Switch. Where the idea was coming from was ETIS, so-called ETIS Base. So the colleagues from Siemens Gamesa providing wind parks and thinking about how to flexibilize such systems was even 15 years ago the answer already. We're talking about storage, a storage system, a huge one, and hopefully a cheap one. And there the idea was born using volcanic stones, also using or taking and thermal storage, because there's nothing cheaper than storing energy in the form of heat. And then the next step was identifying the right material, and that was then volcanic stones. And that was the starting point for Siemens Gamesa to deliver such a system. In these greenfield applications, and last but not least, we see here the third product line of so-called ETIS-ED, just using only the storage system or the building itself and integrating it in an existing industrial heat process. And here would be the advantage of ETIS, especially the high temperature level of currently up to 800 degrees. And there are some industrial processes running on this high temperature levels, especially in the oil industry. If you're talking about the cracking processes and so on and so forth, there's also interest of customer, also interest of customers out of Saudi Arabia regarding this storage system. Meanwhile, good, maybe. That to ETIS. I have additional two slides regarding feasibility studies we already did. So here for a steam power plant in Germany, just to show you what such a system looks like a little bit here in this picture. You have this Persic, you have these air pipes, the heater, and here the storage itself. Here it was the example providing 50 megawatt electrical energy. Charging was 125 megawatt, and the capacity is half a gigawatt. So 6 hours duration output. And we did meanwhile several of these feasibility studies, and so far they're looking at least technically very promising. Good. The next technology is Energy Nest. So Energy Nest is an application based on a specific concrete. And this concrete, maybe a step for this further. You see it here best. you see it here best. Yeah, this are these concrete tubes, and each concrete tubes are four pipes, are iron pipes. Yeah, and this iron pipes is running the heat transfer media. So currently it is heat transformer oil, which is running through these pipes, and due to this, the overall temperature level is limited to 380 degrees because you can't run higher temperatures with this heat transformer oil. But there, and here's, sorry, here you see on this picture, left-hand side, you see this thermal battery. So one battery, you see it's modular approach in this standardized container. You bring in these concrete tubes. Yeah, and then later on, you can staple and bring this together, these different models, and build then a size of the system you like to know, you need, yeah, regarding the capacity and also power output. And what I want to say was that they're currently working on an advanced system that they can direct charge. Here's a system with steam, so we'll bring in steam and charge the energy out of the steam direct in the storage, and later on you can produce direct in the storage itself again steam, and therefore you come to much higher temperatures, and then only limited by the temperature level of the concrete, that's up to 500 degrees, and can also improve the overall system. And for example, you can save needed heat exchanger. So that would be Energy Nest. And here again, the working principle for me is also shown re-electrification. Sorry, and re-electrification. Part, yeah, but that's only to show it completely. Yeah, due to the lower temperature level, you come here not to really sufficient roundup efficiency regarding heat to electricity or electricity to electricity. What if maybe you can think about using organic Rankine cycle to coming up here with the roundup efficiency for electrification, but of course, yeah, also again, organic Rankine cycle would mean here CapEx invest, and therefore we see especially the applications for this thermal battery of Energy Nest for providing heat in industrial applications or for providing district heating energy. Yeah. Good. Last but not least, our third product, THOR here stays for thermal hybrid operation recovery. So what does it mean? We will combine thermal storage with a combined cycle power plant. And the big advantage of this system here is that it is able to be loaded direct by the exhaust gas of the gas turbine. And you know, the exhaust gas temperature is around about also in the area of 500-600 degrees Celsius, and we lose a lot of energy there, behind the gas turbine, in the combination is a little bit lower, the temperature level, but the idea is here to use this energy out of the exhaust gas stored in a thermal storage. This thermal storage based on a specific ceramic. So I don't know the English expression. So for quasi ceramic, so it's not a real ceramic, but somehow something like this. You build small building blocks out of this ceramic, and there you can store the energy in, and as the building blocks are designed in that way, that the back pressure is not too high. The back pressure for the gas turbine is not allowed to exceed 100 millibar. Therefore, there was ETIS not possible for usage here. Therefore, you need the specific design, and that's its store. And that is then again the big advantage that you can combine it with the gas turbine, with the exhaust gas, and load it with the exhaust gas of the gas turbine, and can use then the stored energy, the thermal energy in the Thor system for having in storage available, and for especially flexibilizing the overall system. Like we saw in the battery, we can use the thermal energy for warm keeping of elements of the power plant, to improve the startup behavior. We can provide additional thermal energy for peak load, for example, and so on and so forth. So we overall flexibilize the system of a combined cycle power plant, and having doing this. That would be Thor. This is a relatively early stage of development. So we're currently looking for a development partner to developing a product here. And maybe it will take another 2-3 years in that area until we have a real product available. That is, I think, realistic. Until we can provide here a solution, maybe it could be able to provide a first firm bid offer in the next year. We will see. Also, the working principle here of the store application, as mentioned, you can use the exhaust energy of a gas turbine for loading. Of course, you can, as it is, or also by energy nets, you can also use an easy resistive heater for charging the storage, then via surplus renewables. Overall, had a relatively flexible system regarding the charging side and on the discharging side. As explained, really improves the flexibility of the overall system here. That's the main idea. Good, maybe I can skip this slide due to the time and come to the summary. Storage is somehow key for decarbonization of the future energy systems, and as explained, there's not only one use case there. There are several use cases in the different areas of the generation, the grid, the industry, wherever. And no one technology will fit all of the use cases or the best fit to these use cases. We see batteries as storage of choice, especially for the short duration, up to several hours. Season storage is clear that so far could only useful address then by power to X. I mentioned compressed air and can here play the role and supportive role, but it would be maybe mainly power to X. Thermomechanical storage, what was not really part of this presentation here today, has advantages, especially in the higher round efficiency by making usage of this mechanical power plant standard components. And last but really not least, the thermal storage is beneficial for the low capacity due to the fact that the materials are that cheap. The transport of the volcanic stones are more expensive than the volcanic stones itself. And you have here the big advantage, especially for larger capacities, and there we see the niche. And final statement, I think, and I think you will also agree, we are at the beginning of the storage age, and looking forward what we will see there in the future. So coming to the end, many thanks so far for your attention, and looking forward to your questions.
Thank you, Mr. Grootens. Now we'll move to the Q&A session, and it will be a quick one given the time constraint. So the first question we have is, how do you see the near future potential of using flywheel-based energy storage?
Flywheels, so to my knowledge, flywheels are already available. Yeah, and also, so we as Siemens Energy Generation not provide this specific solution, although I know that other areas of Siemens Energy have these products available. And as said, as we lose more and more inertia by shutting off conventional power plants, we have to bring in solutions, and flywheels will, or can at least, and I think will also play a role here.
The second question we have here is with regards to the effects of the adverse weather conditions that we have here in Saudi Arabia on the power storage efficiency, and whether these extreme conditions were included in your study program.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this question already in the chat, yeah, was already there in Jochen's session, I think.
Should I take the question, Heiko?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, sure. Let's. We have the chance to really account for location-specific weather conditions. Yeah, and we can, for instance, consider the impact of ambient temperature on the coefficient of performance of a chiller, or on the efficiency factor of a gas turbine. So it's our ambition to really consider for this relevant changes in boundary conditions.
Okay, thank you. Now we will move to the raffle ticket event. We will draw from the list of attendees three lucky winners. If your name gets drawn, please contact us and to claim your prize. So Hassan, if you share your screen. Okay, so our first lucky winner is Fawaz. The second winner is Mr. Faisal Al-Dibakel. Congratulations. And our final winner is Mr. Wahab. So now we reach the end of this event. I would like to thank you all for attending, and special thanks to our sponsors, Siemens Energy, for sponsoring this event and sharing the valuable information. And thank you all.
It was a pleasure.
Yeah. It was also a pleasure to me. Yeah? You're welcome.
Thank you, Hassan. Hassan, maybe a final request, if you can put together all the questions and share it with us, and we'll answer them with more details.
Will do, will do.
Yeah?
Will do. Also, if any of the attendees would like to get in touch with the gentleman at Siemens Energy, please contact us at info@hazmi-esas.org. And thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thanks to all.
Thank you all.
Hazmi Group.
Bye.